لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا صدق الله العظيم وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الدنيا سجن المؤمن وجنة الكافر صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين درشي فالله Respected brothers, respected elders, mothers and sisters listening at home, from the entire creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest honor, respect and dignity is given to Hazrat Insan, human beings. From the entire creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the highest position, the highest ranking, honor, respect, dignity is given to human beings, insan. Again, from human beings, from insan, the highest honor, respect and dignity is given to the Muslimin, to the Mu'mineen, to the believers, to those who have surrendered to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, from the Muslimin, from the believers, from those who have surrendered to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the highest honor, respect, dignity is given to those who are the muttaqeen from the believers, those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who live a life of obedience, like how we obey the law of the country whilst driving. When we come to the traffic light and it's at the red color, we have to stop. And when it's green, we go. We respect the law of the country. In the same way, the believers respect the law revealed to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, slowly elevating their position from being just normal Muslims to become muttaqeen. And again, from the muttaqeen, even higher then the ones who obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with total obedience, with taqwa, another higher rank, are those people who are titled with the word shaheed, ash-shuhada, who love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so much that when the time comes, they don't think twice in sacrificing their own life for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even higher than the shuhada, according to the Quranic terminology, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ نَعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُهَدَىٰ وَالصَّالِحِينَ. According to the Quranic terminology, even higher than the shuhada is the siddiqeen, the siddiq, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. Higher than the status of Siddiq is the status of Anbiya alayhimu salatu wa salam, the prophets, who are infallible beings, absolutely protected from all sins. Sins don't come close to Anbiya alayhimu salatu wa salam. They are protected. Divine revelation comes to them. They are the most honorable beings. They are more powerful than even the angels, even more powerful than Jibreel, Mikael, Israfil and Israel, is the status of Anbiya alayhim salatu wassalam. And once again, from all the prophets that were sent, that walked on the face of this earth, the greatest honor and respect is given to Khatamun Nabiyyin, Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was the only prophet to be titled as Imamul Anbiya, the Imam of all the prophets. Ibrahim alayhi salam performed namaz behind him. Musa alayhi salam performed namaz behind him. Isa alayhi salam performed namaz behind him. Chronologically speaking, he came last. But the status has no boundary. Allahu Akbar. The greatest individual figure who is titled as being Sayyidul Awwaleen wal Akhireen, the leader of all those who came before him and all those who come after him. So powerful was his ranking that every prophet, including Adam alayhi salatu was salam, had mentioned his name, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to the community that the prophets were sent to. Every scripture that was revealed to Moses, Musa alayhi salam, to Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, to David, Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam. In every scripture, a clear mentioning of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam was there. In fact, such a lofty status. There is no one in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is remembered like how Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam is remembered. He is remembered throughout the year, 24 hours, every minute and every second. This incredible Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is remembered without a doubt. And just to throw more light to what I have said, make it a bit more easy for the brothers to understand. One has to only travel to Madinatul Munawwara any time of the year, any time of the year, and witness the beautiful Rawza, the resting place of Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the private room of Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Incalculable people stand in front of the Rawza, surrounding the Rawza from all corners, stand up in humility and give their salatu wassalam to Rahmatul Lil Alameen sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Go at 11 o'clock, go at 12 o'clock, go at 1 o'clock, go at 2 o'clock, go after Isha, after 1 hour when the doors of Masjid Nabwi are locked up, then you will see incalculable people outside the Masjid giving salam to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The name, the greeting, the mentioning of Muhammad does not stop sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The only time it stops is when the Imam of Haramain al-Sharifain stand in front of the Musalla, and when they say Allahu Akbar, that is the time the believers have to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fulfill the obligation that Allah has put in front, imposed on them, the fard. The minute the Imam says Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, you see a crowd running towards the Rawza of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, anxious to again greet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when I say 24 hours every second, even when the namaz starts in Masjid Nabawi, there are other Muslims in the world who send salam to the Prophet during that time. So 24 hours in total, Huzur alayhi salatu wa sallam is remembered. By human beings, we won't talk on the subject of angels. The angels are there all the time on the Rawza, in front of the Rawza of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the heavens, everywhere. A group of angels Subhanallah, and the duty is only to send Durood Sharif to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is the status of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah. If he came close to anything, that item becomes precious. If he touches anything, that item becomes invaluable. There is no price to it. You can put a price to Buckingham Palace. You can put a price to anything in this world. But there is no price for anything that has been treasured and respected by Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One example is, he came close to Hajar-e-Aswad, the black stone attached to the Kaaba. He came close, he kissed the black stone. The black stone, Allahu Akbar, has taken place in the heart of every Muslim. The same condition applies to the black stone. 24 hours throughout the year, anytime you go to Haramain al-Sharifain, you will see the Muslims there, piling close to Hajar-e-Aswad, wanting to kiss the black stone. Why? Why do Muslims want to kiss a stone? One must have his aqeedah clear. We are not the people who worship stones. Subhanallah. We are only kissing the stone because that is the sunnah of Prophet Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hazrat Umar Farooq, whilst making tawaf, he stopped the crowd. He said to the people, pointing out to Hajar-e-Aswad, he said, "Inni a'lamu innaka hajarun." I know that you are nothing but a stone. You don't benefit anyone, you don't harm anyone. For if Umar did not see the lips of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam touching you, kissing you, Umar would never come close to you. This is the aqeedah of the believers. And kissing the black stone was a commandment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because that stone is from Jannat, and kissing the stone is a rahmat from Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for his community. For Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, anyone who has kissed the black stone on the day of Qiyamah, that black stone will intercede on behalf of that individual. Will make shafa'at, will say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "So and so person made Umrah or Hajj at so and so time. He came to me, he kissed me." He will give shahada. And by the barakat of that kissing, Allah will open up the doors of Jannat for him. That is why we kiss the black stone. We kiss the black stone not in an act of ibadah, but showing the act of love. Like how the Muslim kisses the Quran, not as an act of ibadah, but as an act of love. Cherishing the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like how the companions kissed the hands of the Prophet and the forehead of the Prophet, not as an act of ibadah, but as an act of love. Similarly, the Muslim kisses the stone, not as an act of ibadah, like the Hindus, but we, Allahu Akbar, kiss it only because it is the sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sunnah is noor. Isa alayhi salatu wa salam. Though we have nothing to do with the present Bible today, though it is corrupted, even today in the Bible it is mentioned, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam said to his disciples, "For I have many things yet to say unto you, but you have no power to bear. For time is short, for the ruler of the world is coming." Who is this ruler of the world? Who can take that place after Isa alayhi salatu wa salam? Who qualifies for that position? The words mentioned in the Bible, "For the ruler of the world is coming." Who is the ruler of the world? None other than Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The ruler of the world is coming, and Isa alayhi salatu wa salam said to his disciples, "He shall teach you over all things," referring to the sunnah, to the actions and to the aqwal, to the sayings of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sunnah is noor. Sunnah is light. Light that comes in this world, light that comes in the grave, light that will come with us in the hereafter. The sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the only thing that makes Islam an independent nation from all. Islam is a religion that can never be dictated, never can Islam be imitated or follow someone? Muslims only follow Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The greatest religion. Wallahi lazeem. And Abu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has educated the ummah on every conceivable subject. Every conceivable subject. Koi bhi mazmoon aapke zehen mein aaye. یہاں کی ہسٹری کی کتابوں میں نہ ہو، ان کے قانون میں نہ ہو، بس ایسا ہو نہیں سکتا کہ آپ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے امت کو اس کی تعلیم نہ دی ہو. No man in this world in the duration of 23 years, 40 years نبوت is given to him. He exits the world at the age of 63. In 23 years with revelation, with Quran, with Sharia, he also educates the ummah of how they are to pare off their nails. Which man, which individual being has educated his community and educated them, teaching them how you are to clip your nails, how to pare off your nails? Koi aisa mujhe bataye dunya mein. Koi aisi zaat dunya mein aayi ho jisne apni qaum ki aisi khidmat ki ho کہ اس کا بھی علم دیا ہو کہ ناخون کس طریقے سے کاٹے جائے. And where are we today? When we have to cut our nails, جی, nail cutter لاؤ بیوی کو, to cut everything without any tartib. We have to do it. But if only if we apply the sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, cutting the nails would become an act of ibadah. Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam would cut his nails. In the riwayat, it comes on a Thursday or a Friday. In the riwayat, the ulama have said that Abu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would start with the right hand, forefinger, his ungis, and then to the middle finger, and then the ring finger, and then the last finger, and then going back to the left hand, the last finger, ring finger, middle finger, forefinger, and the thumb, and then coming back, ending on the right hand thumb. This is the tartib. This is how you cut nails. This is the education, this is the tarteeb of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We cut nails like that, from the right hand start, starting from the index finger, ending at the thumb. Kis cheez ki taaleem aap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ne nahi di? Find any individual from the time of Adam alayhi salatu wa salam, go and scan all the history books in the library, and find out, has any individual taught their community how to wash their body parts, how to make ghusl? There is no system in the world, only in Islam, that has rules and regulation of also ghusl, how to clean your body. Subhanallah. If you talk to someone who is a non-Muslim, he is shocked. Laws and rules and regulations about entering a bath, making ghusl, having a shower. The shower in the modern world is fill the tub up with water and have a few ducks and take a magazine and read. And that's it. That's the modern world bathing system. And that's it. And you just simply get out from the bath, take a towel and spray here and there, and that's it. That is ghusl. No. Ghusl. Allahu Akbar. In the Islamic terminology, Abu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would wash his hands first. Follow me carefully. Apply the sunnah. For even ghusl will become ibadat. Even ghusl will become ibadat. One has to do ghusl. How nice it would be if he applied the sunnah. He never forgets to brush his teeth. He never forgets to use his best perfume and body spray. He never forgets to comb his hair. He never forgets to use his favorite shampoo. But the Muslim today forgets to apply the sunnah to make ghusl and to clean his body. How shameful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on the Muslims. We hear, the Maulana sits and talks, bhai sunnaton par amal karo, sunnaton par amal karo. You go out of the masjid, kaunsi sunnat? It's all out there, lip service. Books are there, you don't need a Maulana. It's all in English.
take time out and read. Read how Huzur alayhi salatu wasalam performed ghusl. Go to Jama'at and learn the sunans. Seek ilm however you can. Seek ilm, sit in the company of ulama or read books. If one is allergic in sitting in the company of ulama, read books. Subhanallah. Doors are there, opened. Different channels and avenues are there. Seek knowledge. Abu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would wash his hands. After that, he would purify the private parts, make istinja. Again, when I say istinja, you're not to do istinja in the bathroom. What I mean is purifying the private parts, the front and the back, make istinja. And if there is impurity on any other body part, clean that off first. Once that is done, Huzur alayhi salatu wasalam would make wuzu, exactly like how we make wuzu for ghusl, namaz. You have a choice to wash your feet in the beginning whilst you're doing wuzu, or even at the end, when you are to complete your ghusl. Once wuzu is completed, wash your hands, wash your private parts, istinja karo, and then make wuzu. Once wuzu is completed, 3 times pour water over your head, making sure water reaches everywhere, on the scalp, on the head, coming down. And then 3 times pour water on the right hand shoulder, pour water in such a way that the water falls all the way down, 3 times. And then finally 3 times again, pour water 3 times on the left hand side. And that is your ghusl completed. Ghusl completed. We don't have to spend hours in the ghusl khana. We don't have to. That is wrong. That is fuzul. Fuzul kharchi. That is wrong. Islam is a simple religion. Once you have purified your body, you get out. Give someone else a chance. 3 farz of ghusl. 2. Wash your mouth thoroughly. And to let the water go inside the nostrils properly, not to suffocate yourself. And finally, making sure that the entire body is drenched with water from head to feet, your ghusl is completed. This is the sunnah, this is the farz of ghusl. Inshallah, we will make amal on this. Inshallah. And if we make amal, even whilst making ghusl, according to the sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the time you spend in the bathroom is ibadah, munkar and Allahu Akbar, the angels are there, the kiraman katibin are there, making note of everything, all the good actions that you have done. Abu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has educated the ummah. It is a pity, my respected brothers. Though books are there, knowledge is there, but we are just busy criticizing. And that is what the Muslim is good for today. Oh, wala molsab MK, ah molsab MK, are bhai, JB keta hoi. Apply the sunnah. Apply the sunnah. Forget everything. Apply the sunnah. What is the sunnah? No. But we are busy criticizing. That person is so, that person is so, that person is so, that person is so. And we are so far away of the sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on us. Huzur alayhi salatu wa sallam, even when he went for his istinja, he said to the ummah that the shayateen and the jinns occupy the toilets, whether it's your house or whether it's anywhere else. They occupy the toilets. Save yourselves from the shayateen and jinn. How do we save ourselves? Huzur alayhi salatu wasalam said, put your left leg foot first in the toilet and before entering say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubusi wal-khabais. Reading that, Allahu Akbar protects you. The shayateen are blocked away from you. Mukhtasar si dua. How many people here sitting in this congregation even know this very basic dua which Huzur alayhi salatu wasalam would read all the time when he would enter the toilet? Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala anha said, قَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِذَا دَخَلَ الْخَلَىٰ. Every time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam entered the toilet, he would read, اللهم إِنِّي أَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنَ الْخُبُسِ وَالْخَبَائِسِ. He would never ever urinate in the bathroom. Never urinate standing up. Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha has mentioned, Man haddathakum annahu kana yabulu qaiman. Anyone who informs you that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam urinated, passed water in the standing posture, fala tusaddiquhu. Don't believe him. Ma kana yabulu illa qa'idan. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only passed water in the sitting position. Today you go to Muslim countries in public sectors to follow and to imitate the kuffar. Muslims today, Allahu Akbar, because they don't perform salah, will casually urinate standing up. Allahu Akbar. And Huzur alayhi salatu wasalam took every precaution. Abu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَإِنَّ عَامَّةَ عَذَابَ الْقَبْرِ, that the punishment in the grave is connected with the qatarat of peshab, the drops of urine. Huzur alayhi salatu wasalam, being a prophet, everything internally and externally was parked for Huzur alayhi salatu wasalam, but yet he would be extra cautious, making sure not a single drop. And even from Muslims using the masjid toilet, they stand up and urinate. Stand up and urinate. And you can see peshab everywhere. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on the ummah. Where are we from the sunan of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my respected brothers? Some of the adab, Huzur, time does not allow me, Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam would wear and cover his head when he went to the toilet. Never smoke in the toilet. Smoking in the toilet is not right. Never read magazines. Take a book. Pass your time in the toilet. That is not the area where you want to read and seek knowledge. Allahu Akbar. Never spit in the toilet. The shayateen are there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give us the tawfiq. Majority of the people would even forget, because at that precise time the shaitan is there trying his very hard to make that individual forget the dua, to make that individual forget the sunan of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give us the tawfiq. A simple plea to the brothers here, come and sit in the dars, sit in the masajid, have connection with the ulama, ask them what is the sunnah, ask them, read books, apply the basic sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give us the tawfiq to make amal on what has been said. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.